शिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पाद शंकरं लोकशंकरं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्य कृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। सो वी वर रेफरिंग टू so we made a reference to the two types of vritti that is present in any word, shaktam padam. So the two types of vritti, one is shakti, the other is lakshana. So this is called the primary significative power present in a word, primary significative power, and the second one is secondary significative power. So every word is capable of conveying through the primary significative power a meaning which is called the primary meaning or shakyartha, and through the secondary significative power it conveys what is known as lakshyartha or secondary meaning. Now whenever a word is uttered normally it is bound to give rise to the shakyartha, or through the primary significative power it is bound to give rise to the shakyartha or the primary meaning. But in some cases what would happen is, in a sentence if the word gives rise to the shakyartha and if the shakyartha fails to be associated with the meaning of the other word in a sentence, then there would arise what is known as anvaya anupapatti, means there is unintelligibility. Anvaya means syntactical relation. So there arises unintelligibility in the syntactical relation in a sentence among the word meanings. So normally all the words are bound to give rise to only the shakyartha or the primary meaning. But in some cases, as we explained in the case of Gangayam Goshaha, what happens? It means group of houses on the banks, a group of houses, group of Gosha means group of houses. Gangayam means the word Ganga conveys the sense of the current of the river. That is the primary, through the primary significative power, the word Ganga conveys this artha, current of the river, which is the shakyartha. Now the word Gosha conveys the sense of group of houses. Group of houses, this is the primary meaning. Now if we take into consideration only the primary meaning of the words constituting this sentence, then you have to, what will be the sentence meaning? Group of houses on the current of the river, which appears to be incompatible. There is no anvaya, there is no syntactical relation of these two words. That means you cannot have this as the meaning. So what happens? The word Ganga, it gives up its primary meaning, totally gives up its primary meaning, namely the current of the river, and conveys a meaning which is somewhat related to the current of the river. And through what power does it convey that meaning? Through the secondary significative power, which is called lakshana. So through the secondary significative power it conveys the sense of banks of the river or tira. So Ganga tire goshaha, the sentence as a whole would convey the sense of Ganga tire goshaha. So Gangayam Goshaha. Now, when do you resort to, when do you take recourse to Lakshana? Recourse to Lakshana is taken only where there is incompatibility, or where there is anupapatti or unintelligibility in the syntactical relation among the word meanings in a sentence. Then you have to take recourse to Lakshana. So that is what he mentions in the verse number 34. Shaktehe purvameva nirupitatvat tan nirupanam upekshya lakshanam nirupayitum upakramate. Now in the previous verse we have made a mention of shaktya lakshanaya vapi vakyam swartham prabodayet. So he has referred to the two types of vritti in a word. One is a shakti and another is lakshana. Why he has not mentioned about shakti? He says that avatarika grantha, he says shaktehe purvameva nirupitatvat. Earlier we have referred or we have explained what is meant by shakti in verse number, the previous verse. What is that verse we have done? Shaktihi sanketaha. Yes. Verse number 25. Shaktihi sanketaha ityeke padarthantaram ityapi. So there we have made a mention or we have explained what is meant by shakti. So shaktehe purvameva nirupitatvat tan nirupanam upekshya. Upeksham is, now you see, we give up explaining what is meant by shakti, or we leave it and then we go to explain lakshanam nirupayitum upakramate. He starts or he begins explaining what is meant by lakshana. Anvayanupapattau tu mukhyarthasya parigrahe. Now, when do you take recourse to lakshana? Mukhyarthasya parigrahe. If you consider the primary meaning of the word, mukhyarthas, if you consider, if you take into consideration the mukhyartha or the shakya, shakyartha, mukhyartha, the alankarikas give the word abhidha, all these are synonyms. They are used interchangeably. So shakyartha, primary meaning, mukhyartha, all these are the same. So alankarikas, the all rhetoricians will use the term abhidha. Now, mukhyarthasya parigrahe, if you take into consideration the mukhyartha or the primary meaning or the shakyartha, then what happens? There is anvaya anupapatti. There is unintelligibility in the syntactical relation. So anvaya anupapattau tu mukhyarthasya parigrahe anvaya anupapatti hi syat. Then what happens? Mukhyartha sambandini arte. See, that word is very, very important. Mukhyartha sambandini arte pratitihi lakshanamata. Then that is considered, you resort, you take recourse to lakshana. And what is lakshana? It is, the lakshana is the secondary significative power through which a word conveys a meaning. That phrase is very important. Mukhyartha sambandini arte. It refers to a meaning called lakshyartha, or the secondary meaning, which is related to the mukhyartha. It is not totally unrelated, but at the same time, it leaves out the primary meaning totally and conveys a meaning which is related to the primary meaning. Mukhyartha sambandini arte pratitihi. The knowledge which you arrive at in such a sense, then that is called lakshana mata. So the commentary thereon is anvaya anupapattau iti. He says gangayam goshaha ityadau gangapada mukhyarthasya pravahasya parigrahe. Now, in the case of Gangayam Goshaha, what is the primary meaning of the word Ganga? Ganga padasya, Ganga pada mukhyartaha kaha, pravaha rupa artaha. So, Ganga pada mukhyartasya, pravahasya parigrahe. If you consider, if you take into consideration, if you understand the word Ganga to mean its primary meaning, namely the current of the river or pravaha, then tasya gosha adharatva anupapatya, it cannot become the adhara, or in the current of the river, you cannot explain the presence of the group of houses. So gosha adharatva anupapatya. So this meaning is unintelligible. You cannot relate the meaning of the word Ganga, namely the current of the river, to the meaning of the word gosha, namely the group of houses, because it appears unintelligible. You cannot say group of houses on the current of the river. So gosha padarthena anvaya anupapattau, when there is such a unintelligibility in the syntactical relation, then what do you do? Mukhyartha bhuta pravaha sambadde mukhyartha bhuta pravaha means pravaha which is the mukhyartha or the primary meaning, and mukhyartha bhuta pravaha sambadde a meaning which is related to such a primary meaning. Pravaha sambadde tire ya pratitihi. Pratitihi means knowledge, jnanam. So when you arrive at the knowledge of the tira which is related to the primary meaning, then sa lakshanayaiva vachya. So you have to consider that meaning which you have arrived at in this process, it is only through the secondary significative power, namely lakshana, and such a meaning which you have arrived at is called lakshyartha. Sa lakshanayaiva vachya iti mukhyartha sambandha lakshana iti bhavaha. This is the meaning. See, he concludes by saying mukhyartha sambandha. The general meaning of lakshana, the general definition of lakshana is mukhyartha sambandha lakshana iti bhavaha. So anvaya anupapattautu mukhyarthasya parigrahe mukhyartha sambandini arte pratitihi lakshana mata. Is there any doubt? Shall I proceed? Okay. Then, now a question is asked. Nanu evam visham. This is again, you see, he is giving an avatarika. Why? What is the need for the next verse? So far we have finished that what is the definition of lakshana. Now the next verse goes as tatparya anupapattirva lakshana bijam uchyate. Now in the previous verse, just now we have mentioned that we take recourse to lakshana when there is unintelligibility in the syntactical relation. Anvaya anupapattihi is lakshana bija. Lakshana bija means when do you resort to lakshana? When there is unintelligibility in anvaya. But in the immediately next verse, he says tatparya anupapattirva, or else you can also say tatparya anupapatti is lakshana bija. Now, where is the need for giving this statement tatparya anupapattirva? For that, the author, the commentator, gives an avatarika. He gives a prefatory note for the need for the next verse. Nanu evam visham bhunkshva ityadav bhojana nivritti pratitihi nasyat vishasya bhojane karmataya anvaya sambhavena tad anupapatyabhavat lakshana anupapattehe ityashankya tatparya anupapattireva lakshana bijam iti siddhantamaha. Now this is the stock example. Gangayam Ghoshaha is the stock example for explaining any kind of lakshana. There are so many examples you can give for lakshana, and the varieties of lakshana also we will be seeing a little later. Now take the case of this statement visham bhunkshva. Means eat poison. Now imagine this is a statement made by the father to his son. The son has gone and he has taken food in an enemy's house. The father doesn't like that person. The son has gone to his place and he has taken food there, and he comes and reports to the father, "Oh well, I went to his house. He compelled me to take food there. So I have taken food there." Immediately the father is very much frustrated, he is very furious, and he says, "You take poison." That means taking food in his house is equal to taking poison. This is what he wants to convey. So you take poison means immediately he will not go pitruvakya paripalana, I have to take poison. The father himself says nobody does that. No, he has consumed food at his house, the enemy's house. The father thinks that it is equal to taking poison.
You should have told that you have eaten poison, but you poison.
Yeah, visham bhunkshva means, you see, it is equal to taking poison. That is what he means. Eat poison, visham bhunkshva. You take poison. You take poison means it is as good as taking poison instead of taking food at the enemy's house. This in that context he makes such a statement. Now, this visham bhunkshva, if you look into this sentence as such, you see, it is not like the case of Gangayam Ghoshaha. Eat poison when it is said, there is no incompatibility or there is no unintelligibility in the syntactical relation. Eat poison means eat bread, eat idli, like that, any other, eating any other object, any other food item, eat poison means it gives rise to a correct meaning. But in the absence of any anvaya anupapatti or any unintelligibility among the word meanings, visham means it conveys the sense of poison, and bhungsha means take poison. So this is what it conveys. There is no unintelligibility among the word meanings in this sentence as such. But in the absence of any anvaya anupapatti, unintelligibility, yet this sentence cannot be taken or cannot mean, it cannot be taken in its face value, because something more than this is intended by the father or intended by the speaker. So what the father wants to convey is the taking food at the enemy's house is equal to taking poison. So you need not have taken food there. So it is equal to taking poison. This is what he wants to convey. So such a tatparya, the intention of the speaker, will not become intelligible. So he says, nanu evam visham bhungshva ityadav bhojana nivritti. This means, what does the father want to convey? Hereafter, you should not take food at his house. This is what the father wants to convey. So when he says visham bhungshva, if you take food at the enemy's house, it is equal to taking poison. So instead of taking food there, you can eat poison as well. So that is what he wants to. This kind of tatparya or the intention of the speaker will not become intelligible if the mere meaning of the sentence is taken into consideration. So both nanu evam visham bhungshva ityadu bhojana nivritti pratitihi. Nivritti pratiti means he has to desist himself from going to the enemy's house and taking food there. That pratitihi, that such a cognition will not arise from this statement. Nasyat. Why? Vishasya bhojane karmataya anvaya sambhavena. See, you can take one bhojanataya, visha, it can serve as a bhojana. Vishasya bhojane, there is no anvaya can happen. Vishasya bhojane karmataya anvaya, it can become the object of eating. So, vishasya bhojanataya anvaya sambhavena tad anupapatyabhavat. Tad anupapatyabhavat means anvaya anupapatyabhavat. There is no anvaya anupapatti. There is syntactical relation. Abhavat. So what happens? There is no, nobody will take recourse to lakshana in this sentence, as far as this sentence is concerned. So lakshana anupapattehe, there is no need for lakshana in such cases. Lakshana anupapattehe ityashankya. So what does he say? Tatparya anupapattireva lakshana bijam iti siddhantamaha. So the Advaitins are of the view, because for them tatparya vishayi bhuta samsargaha yatra manantarena na badyate tadvakyam pramanam. How do the Advaitins define agama pramana? Yasya tatparya vishayi bhuta samsargaha manantarena na badyate tadrisha vakyam pramanam. So in the cases of tatparya vishayi bhuta samsargaha, वाक्यस्य तात्पर्य विषयीभूत संसर्गः मानांतरेण न बाध्यते. न बाध्यते तद्वाक्यं प्रमाणम्. नो, देयर आर टू इंस्टेंसेस विच दद्वैत आदित्यो यूपः एंड यजमानः प्रस्तरः. देयर आर टू वैदिक स्टेटमेंट्स हियर. आदित्यो यूपः मीन्स द सन, द सैक्रिफिशियल पोस्ट इज द सन. The sun is the sacrificial post. Now, the sacrificial post can never be identical with the sun. The sun is something different, the sacrificial post is different. And then yajamana prastaraha means darbamushti visheshaha. Prastaraha means darbamushti visheshaha. So, that is equated with the yajamana or the per sacrificer himself. So now there seems to be some unintelligibility in having these as the word meanings. So sacrificial post, it is opposed to perception, isn't it? So if you equate the sun, or if you equate the sacrificial post with the sun, it is opposed to perception. How can the sacrificial post be the sun? So then the Advaitins go on to say, what is intended to be conveyed by the statement, or what is the intention of the Vedic statement is, Tatparya Vishaya here is, it is desired to be conveyed that the Upa or the sacrificial post is as brilliant as the sun. This is the intention, or this is the Tatparya, or the true import that is desired to be conveyed by this statement. And in the same way, the Darbha Mushti Vishesha, that is Darbha Mushti, that is the handful of Darbha grass, that is as important as the sacrificer. Yajamanaha Prastaraha, when it is said, that is as important as the sacrificer himself. This is what is to be intended to be conveyed by the second statement. Now, this is the Tatparya. So, whenever the Vedic statement is uttered, if this Tatparya is not sublated by any other Pramana, then such a statement is treated to be valid. Now, this Tatparya, what is opposed to perception, is only the mere word meanings. But what is intended to be conveyed by the Vedas is that the sacrificial post is as brilliant as the sun. Such a true import is not contradicted by any other Pramana. What is contradicted by perception is only when you make an identity between the Upa and Aditya. That is opposed to perception. But that is only Mukhyartha. So the intended meaning is not sublated by any other Pramana. So these sentences are also valid, because Tatparya Vishayibhuta Samsargaha Etasmin Vakye Na Bad, it is not sublated. So this is considered to be Pramana. Samsarga means relation. Tatparya Vishayibhuta Samsargaha, Samsargaha Pada Yanvayaha Padarthana Manvayaha. Now take the case of Visham Bhukshva. So now in Visham Bhukshva, you cannot explain, or you cannot explain Lakshana in these cases, in this case, by resorting to Anvayanupapatti, because there is no Anvayanupapatti at all. So he says Lakshana Bijam. So according to the Advaitins, it is only Tatparya Anupapatti that is Lakshana Bija, and not Anvayanupapatti as such. So Tatparya Anupapattir Va Lakshana Bijam Uchyate Visham Bhukshva Ityadi Vakyam Tan Nivrittim Hi Bodhayet. Unless you explain the intention of the speaker, that is, taking food at the enemy's house is equal to taking poison, this kind of Tatparya, the intention of the speaker, would hold this, would not be conveyed unless this the word as such, the sentence as such, there is no unintelligibility among the word meanings. But this Tatparya will not become intelligible unless you take recourse to Lakshana, because Visham Bhukshva means taking food at enemy's house is equal to taking Visha. So this Tatparya cannot fit in this context. Although there is Anvaya, Tatparya Anupapatti, there is Tatparya Anupapatti, because what the father wants to convey is, you should not take food anymore at the enemy's house. That means it is equal to taking poison. This meaning, or this Tatparya of the father, cannot be had if the word Visham Bhukshva, or if the word eat poison, if it is taken in its face value. So he understands from this statement that eating poison at his house is equal to, I mean, eating food at such and such a place is equal to taking poison. So hereafter I should desist taking food at his house. So tan nivrittihi, that's what he says, Visham Lakshanaya Tatparyeti Visham Bhukshva Ityadi Vakyam Tan Nivrittim Hi Bodhaye Tan Visham Bhukshva. What does it say? The meaning of the sentence is eat poison, but actually it is the reverse of it that it conveys. No, Tatparya, the intention of the speaker, it's not Vyangyartha. Advaitins do not admit Vyangyartha. So Visham Bhukshva means go and eat poison. Means immediately he understands, okay, I have.
What is the
Vyangyartha means through vyanjana vyapara, there is another vyapara. We are dealing with that in little later, Swamiji. I will explain it there. So tatparya anupapattirva lakshana bijam uchyate visham bhunkshva ityadi vakyam tan nivrittim hi bodhayet tatparyeti visham bhunkshva ityadau dvishadanna bhojana nivrittehe. So you should not take food in the enemy, at enemy's house. Dvishadanna bhojana nivrittehe tatparya vishayetva. What is the intention of the speaker? The speaker intends to convey that you should no more take food at his house. Dvishadanna bhojana nivrittehe tatparya vishayetva. And such a pratiti, how it is arrived at? Lakshanaya tat pratitihi iti bhavaha. So tatparya anupapatti. So there are two kinds of anupapatti. One is anvaya anupapatti and the other is tatparya anupapatti. Now in some cases you can explain that anvaya anupapatti is lakshana bija, but in some other cases you may explain that tatparya anupapatti is lakshana bija. Now let us do one more example. Yashti praveshaya. Yashti praveshaya. Old persons with the stick are standing in the mud and free bhojana is given there. So the manager of that mud comes out and he informs the secretary. Yashti praveshaya, he makes the statement, send all the sticks inside. Now immediately nobody goes and collects all the sticks and sends them inside. The meaning of the word sentence as such is yashti praveshaya, send all the sticks inside, isn't it? So the word, the sentence yashti praveshaya means send all the sticks inside. So in this context, what will the secretary understand? Okay, I should first send inside all those who are having the yashti. Oh, yashti dhare lakshana. All those who are bearing the stick in their hand, all the elderly persons should be sent inside first, then the youngsters. So he understands this tatparya. Yashti praveshaya, as such the word, the sentence conveys the correct meaning. Send all the sticks means where there is any unintelligibility in anvaya. There is absolute anvaya there. So there is no anvaya anupapatti. Even in the absence of anvaya anupapatti, you resort to lakshana in this case also. Why? Because what is the intention of the speaker? What does he want to convey in that context? He wants to say, those who are having the sticks in the hands, that is all the elderly persons, they have to be sent inside first and then the others. So yashti praveshaya, in this case at least, there is no anvaya anupapatti, but there is tatparya anupapatti. So here is another instance wherein you have tatparya anupapatti. In the case of Gangayam Goshaha, of course there is anvaya anupapatti, so there is lakshana. Let us consider one more example. Now we have not gone into the varieties of lakshana. I am just giving a general examples of lakshana. There is one more example. Kakebhyo dadi rakshyatam. Protect the curd from the crows. The sentence means protect the curd from the crows. Now when this is uttered, protect the curd from the crows, is there any anvaya anupapatti here? No. Absolutely the meaning holds good and you are expected to protect the curd from the crows. Now a cat comes and licks the curd. Does he keep quiet? Because he has asked me to protect it only from the crow, I should not mind. Let it eat. Nobody keeps quiet. Immediately, you prevent the cat licking that curd. So what does it mean? If it merely means that it has to be protected only from the crows, that is, there is no anvaya anupatti. There is anvaya. There is pakka. There is intelligibility among the word meaning. But in spite of that, this word kaka not only convey the sense of crow, this is a case of ajaha lakshana, which we are going to read later. So not only it not only conveys the sense of crow, but whatever that is, that dyupagataka, whatever factor that would destroy the curd, all those are included. So all those are conveyed secondarily. Now, how could you take this as an example of lakshana at all? Because kakebhyo dadi rakshata, if anvayanupapatti were to be maintained as the cause of resorting to lakshana, then in these cases, yashti praveshaya kakebhyo dadi rakshata, nobody could take recourse to lakshana at all. So, considering all these examples, perhaps the Advaitins would have thought that it is the tatparya, because the very definition of pramana for the Advaitin agama pramana is tatparya vishayi bhuta samsarga. So at the back of his mind, the Advaitins are not very much convinced with this kind of explanation, that is anvaya anupapatti, as in the case of gangayam goshaha. So they give up this anvaya anupapatti as lakshana bija. So they have given tatparya anupapatti as lakshana bija. Now one question that remains is, will you have two different kind of anupapatti in order to take recourse to lakshana? In some cases it is anvaya anupatti, in some cases it is tatparya anupatti. Now even those cases where anvaya anupatti we are explaining, that is gangayam goshaha, also can be maintained as tatparya anupatti, because the speaker, the intention of the speaker when he says gangayam goshaha, gangatira gosha vritti tatparyena bodaha, that is when I make the statement gangayam goshaha, I intend to convey the sense of gangatira vritti gosha tatparyena tadrisham vakyam maya prayuktam. So such an intention of the speaker, that is you have to, in order to maintain uniformity, we have to explain this kind of tatparya anupati even in the case of gangayam goshaha. No doubt in gangayam goshaha as it is, it appears only to be anvaya anupati, but we cannot maintain in some cases anvaya anupati, some cases tatparya anupati. One cannot, in almost all the cases you can speak of tatparya anupati. So in order to maintain a uniformity, you also explain tatparya anupati in the case of gangayam goshaha. So uniformly we maintain that tatparya anupapatti is lakshana bija in all cases. Yes, Swamiji. He has given, but the conclusive viewpoint of the Nayayikas also is only tatparya anupati, because he has very specifically stated even in gangayam goshaha, because we have to maintain uniformity, that well, if you feel so, you can accept. But if you want to maintain that only one anupapatti could be the cause of resorting to lakshana, then you can always explain. That is another kind of interpretation I just wanted to give. That is what the Nayayikas have concluded, tatparya anupapatti, because all cases you have to maintain uniformly, something is the cause. So in some cases, it's, now how will you fix a karya karan bhava? It is a, whether it is anvaya anupatti or tatparya anupatti, you have to find out. So if you want to maintain a uniform kind of anupapatti in order to take recourse to lakshana, then tatparya anupatti can be explained even in the case of gangayam goshaha. So but of course tatparya anupapatti va means either this or that. Anvaya anupatti can be lakshana bija or tatparya anupapatti. So tatparya anupapatti va lakshana bijam uchyate visham bhunkshva ityadi vakyam tan nivrittim hi bodhayet. Yes, Swamiji. Tatparya anupapatti. That is the conclusion of the Nayayika. No, from what it appears from the, in this text, you know, at least anvaya anupapatti mukhyartha sabrika tatparya anupapatti also is accepted, either anvaya anupapatti or tatparya anupapatti. But to my mind, it appears that even the Advaitins have to admit tatparya anupapatti even in the case of gangayam goshaha, because after all, these are all secular examples. Why should they be bothered about? It is better if you admit tatparya anupati in all cases. We will maintain uniformity. Anyway, I will just look into Vedanta Paribhasha. What is the, he makes a distinction, or he discusses about this point. I will have a look into the text and I will let you know. Okay. Tatpariya anupati, but he makes a mention in the Vedanta paribhasha. Yes? Okay. Yes. That is Pidruvakya Pariparana he wanted to do. So he didn't want to Satyavak. So that is why he went. And the father, he did not take the intention of the father, what he intended in Nachiketas. Yeah, that happens sometimes. So Tatpratitihi iti bhavaha. Then Atha Lakshanam Vibhajate. Now we have explained the bija or the karana of resorting to lakshana. Now what are the types of lakshana? He says Atha Lakshanam Vibhajate Lakshanacha Tridha Prokta Jahatya Jahati Tata Vachika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha. Now there are three types of lakshana. Lakshana is the secondary significative power and it is of three types. Jahal Lakshana, Ajahal Lakshana, and then Jahad Ajahal Lakshana. So, how do the philosophers define this kind of lakshana? Lakshana, the underlying principle is that it is a meaning which is conveyed by the secondary significative power in a word, and it is a meaning which is related to the primary meaning, shakyartha sambandha. Now, this jagal lakshana is also called Jaganya Lakshana. Now the usual example that is given is Gangayam Goshaha says Vachika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha Lakshanacha Trida Prokta Jagatyajahati Tata Vachika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha. That is the Jagadajah Lakshana. Okay. Now there are two meanings for a word. One is the Shakyartha or the Vachyartha. The primary meaning. Now, where a word totally gives up its primary meaning, jahyate, tyajyate, swarthaha, that the power through which a word totally abandons or gives up its primary meaning and conveys a meaning related to it, then such a type of lakshana is called jahal lakshana. Jahyate, Tyajyate. Swarthaha. It meaning its primary meaning, then totally it gives up its primary meaning. Then such a kind of lakshana is called Jahal Lakshana. So the example that is usually given is Gangayam Goshaha. Also this yashti praveshaya manchaha kroshanti, the cradles cry manchaha kroshanti, manchastha purushaha or manchastha balaha. So all these are examples of jahal lakshana, where the word completely leaves out its primary meaning and conveys a meaning related to yashti. Dhare lakshana means it does not convey the sense of yashti or the stick, but those who are possessed of the sticks. So that is the yes. Yes, she also should go along with the fellows. but it can also mean jaha lakshana, because you may yashti dhare lakshana means, yashti dhare means those who are possessed of the sticks, those who are possessed, the emphasis is only on the persons who are possessed of the sticks. The sticks do not form part of the secondary meaning. So yashti dhare lakshana, when you say, that is a example of jahal lakshana. So these are the examples. Now in the case of ajahal lakshana, what happens is, where your word conveys two meanings, one is shakyartha and another is lakshyartha. Now without leaving its shakyartha, it conveys something more than that. Na jahyate swarthah, it does not leave out its meaning, primary meaning, but it conveys something more than that primary meaning, that is lakshyartha. Then such a one is called ajahal lakshana, where it retains the primary meaning. And also conveys a meaning related to it. Now the example, the very best example is kakebhyo dadi rakshyatam, protect the curd from the crows. So in this case, the word kakebhyaha not only conveys the sense of kaka, but also those which are the detrimental factors, or which are the destructive factors of the curd. So kake akake cha lakshana, the word kaka, kake akake cha, it conveys secondarily akake, all those which are different from crows. So it retains the primary meaning, namely the crow, and also conveys something more than that, namely akaka. So that is an example of ajahal lakshana. Ajahal lakshana, where the primary meaning is retained and also something more than the primary meaning is conveyed, then it is ajahal lakshana. Then jahad ajahal lakshana, it is also called as bhagatyaga lakshana. Bhagatyaga lakshana. Now the usual example, the secular example that is given is soyam devadattaha, this is that devadatta. This is that devadatta. Now this is that devadatta, the word this and that, saha etat devadatta tad devadatta. Now these two words convey the sense of devadatta as related to different place and different time. So the word etat devadatta, etat conveys the sense of devadatta as related to the present time and this particular place, and tad devadatta conveys the sense of devadatta as related to a past time and a different place. Now when that devadatta is directly in front of me, I have the recognition, this is that devadatta. Now what happens, devadatta, the adjectives for devadatta happens to be different place and different time, and this particular place and this time, these two adjectives differ, because devadatta, the person in devadatta, you have different place, different time, and this place and this time. Now these two, devadatta, tad devadatta, the devadatta as associated with the different place and different time, so this is that devadatta means, the word that conveys the sense of devadatta related to a different place and different time, and etat devadatta means it conveys the sense of devadatta related to a present time and a particular place. Now, the adjectival features are mutually opposed to each other. So, there cannot be identity in the person Devadatta, because the adjectival features to Devadatta, in one case it is different time and a different place, and in another case it is that this particular place and this particular time. So what do the words do? Tat and etat, what do? They leave out a part of their primary meaning, namely the adjectival features, different time and a different place, and this particular time and this particular place. These two meanings, they are left out, and the portion of the primary meaning, namely Devadatta, that alone is retained, and the identity in the person Devadatta is conveyed. So this is a secular example. So this is an instance where a bhaga, the primary meaning, a bhaga or a portion of the primary meaning is left out, and another portion is conveyed secondarily. Now, after finishing, tomorrow if there is time, I will make a mention. This Dharmaraja Dorindra, he has made a very good contribution in his Vedanta Paribhasha. He says, this is not at all an instance of Lakshana. The Janada Jaha Lakshana need not at all be accepted by the Advaitins. Because he says, even the Vishishta Advaitins criticize the Advaitins. In this case, what is the primary meaning of Tat and Etat? Taddesha Tatkala Vishishta Devadatta is one primary meaning, and Etaddesha Etatkala Devadatta is another primary meaning. Now, Devadatta forms part of the primary meaning. We should bear that in mind. Now, when we speak of Lakshana, what do we say? Since the identity cannot be maintained if we consider only the primary meanings of these two terms, we are forced to give up a part of the primary meaning and then retain only another part in order to convey the identity of the person in Devadatta. Now, there is the difficulty. Devadatta, who forms part of the primary meaning, Taddesha Tatkala Vishishta Devadatta, that is the primary meaning of the word Tat. And Etaddesha Etatkala Vishishta Devadatta, this is the primary meaning of the word Etat. Now, we have been given to understand that something, the Shakyartha is totally given up in the first case, it is totally given up, and something related to the Shakyartha is conveyed, that is Jahal Lakshana. Where the Shakyartha is retained and something else is secondarily conveyed, so we maintain the identity of the Shakyartha. We don't say that is the Rakshyartha, it is the Shakyartha, and something other than the Shakyartha is also conveyed secondarily. So the Lakshyartha is different from the Shakyartha there also, in the case of Ajahal Lakshana also. But consider this case. What is the Shakyartha is Etaddesha Etatkala Vishishta Devadatta and Taddesha Tatkala Vishishta Devadatta. Now, in order to convey the identity of the person in Devadatta, what do? We leave out a part of the primary meanings in Tat and Etat, namely the adjectival features, different time, this time, all these we leave out, and we retain another part, namely Devadatta. Now, the part which has been retained, namely the person in Devadatta, has been already conveyed primarily. It forms part of the primary meaning. So, what has been primarily conveyed once, that itself is being secondarily conveyed by this power of Lakshana, Jahad Ajaya Lakshana. This seems to be somewhat contradictory, because when we speak of Lakshana, in the other two cases, either the Lakshana or the Lakshyartha is totally different from the Shakyartha, or something other than the Shakyartha is conveyed secondarily, isn't it? In the earlier two instances. Do you understand? So, in the earlier two instances, we are very well able to admit something as the Lakshyartha. But in the present case, Devadatta forms part of the primary meaning. So, either you accept that in order to have relation among the word meanings, we give up a part of it and the identity is conveyed, don't speak of lakshana at all. That is in order to vishishtayoho aikyam nasambhavati. So that visheshana is visheshana parityagena visheshya matra bodaha, you just remain by saying so. But why, one second, let me finish it. But why do you say that the word tat, the words tat and etat, leaving out a part of its primary meaning, namely tat, the taddesha tatkala and etat desha etatkala, and convey the person in Devadatta secondarily? What seems to be contradictory is Devadatta forms part of the primary meaning, and Devadatta also is conveyed secondarily through this power of lakshana, that is jahad ajahal lakshana. This is not admissible for the Dharmaraja Adhurindra. So he gives an entirely different view for jahad ajahal lakshana. And if this is not to be treated as jahad ajahal lakshana, then what would be the example of jahad ajahal lakshana? He says kakebhyo dadhi rakshatam is jahad ajahal lakshana. He says kakebhyo dadhi rakshatam, which we have given as ajahal lakshana, he says kake akake cha lakshana. You retain, that is dad yupagatakatva vishishta veshena, it conveys the sense of that is whatever that is different from crows, that is ajahal lakshana example, which I will explain tomorrow in my class. So this is that Devadatta. This poses a problem. This cannot be taken as an example of jahad ajahal lakshana. And extending this line of argument, even in the case of Tattvamasi Mahavakya, Dharmaraja Durindra does not admit jahad ajahal lakshana. Now we will explain Tattvamasi. Before that, he wanted to ask something. No. It's totally different. You see, there are two words there. Gosha, whether it is primary meaning or secondary meaning of the word Ganga, Gosha is going to convey the meaning of the group of houses only. There is no discrepancy in that meaning. We are concerned in that case, Gangayam Goshaha, we are more concerned only with the word Ganga. The word Ganga, should it convey the current of the river or the banks of the river? That is the point at issue. We are not concerned about the gosha there. Now, but this is an instance of pratyabhijna where two words are involved. You have to speak of the identity between the two words constituting the sentence, which is conveyed by the two words. So when you speak of such an identity, the words, they have to retain only a part of the primary meaning and convey another part secondarily. This is where the problem lies. Do you understand the problem in the present case? This is not similar to Gangayam Goshaha. You have to understand the difference between the two. Gangayam Goshaha is totally different. Swamiji? Okay. So about that, how Vedanta Paribhashakara accept that, I will explain tomorrow. So Lakshanacha Tridha Prokta Jahatya Jahati Tata. Now let us examine this in the case of Tattvamasi Mahavakya. This is the secular example given for jahad ajahal lakshana. In the case of Tattvamasi, it is interpreted by resorting to jahad ajahal lakshana. So the word tat, you are that. Tat conveys the sense of consciousness, pure consciousness, as associated with omniscience, sarvajnyatva, sarvajnyatva vishishta chaitanya. And then tvam conveys the sense of consciousness associated with kinchignyatva or limited knowledge. Now, what is the element that is common to these two meanings? The consciousness element is common in these two meanings. So these are the two primary meanings or the mukhyartha conveyed by the term tat and tvam. Now, when you speak of the identity between the meanings of the words tat and tvam, the meanings as such are consciousness, sarvajnyatva vishishta chaitanya and kinchignyatva vishishta chaitanya, and there cannot be any identity between these two in view of the fact that the adjectival elements, namely the omniscience and limited knowledge, these two are opposed to each other. So there cannot be any identity between these two meaning. So what do? We give up a part of the primary meaning, namely sarvajnyatva and kinchignyatva, and then what would remain is the consciousness element, and the identity between the consciousness element is conveyed tattvamasi, in tattvamasi mahavakya. So this is the example. The Soyam Devadatta is the secular example, and Tattvamasi is the sacred example that is given to explain Jahad Ajahal Lakshana. Now, in Vedanta Paribhasha, he totally gives up, there is no Lakshana at all in Tattvamasi Mahavakya, he says, which we'll see tomorrow. Now, what he says is, Vachyika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha. This is Jahad Ajahal Lakshana. Vachya Eka Bhaga, one part of it is given up. Vachyika Bhaga, that is why it is also called Bhagatyaga Lakshana. One part is retained and one part is abandoned. So, Vachyika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha Lakshana cha iti Traividyameva Aha Jahati iti Dvitiyam Aha Ajahati iti. So the commentator feels whatever that has been explained in the sloka, he doesn't want to explain it further. Ajahati iti Tritiya, but the Tritiya, the third one, he wants to explain a little. Bhagatyaga Rupam Tritiyam, the third one, Jahad Ajahal Lakshana, which is otherwise termed Bhagatyaga Lakshana, means one Bhaga is abandoned and the other Bhaga is retained. Bhagatyaga Rupam, and what is it known as? Jahad Ajahal Lakshana Para Namadeyam, which is also known by the name Jahad Ajahal Lakshana. Vivakshuhu Tal Lakshana Vidana Purvakam Nirdishati. So, what is intended to be conveyed by the Granthakarta, Vivakshuhu Tal Lakshana Vidana Purvakam, by this sentence, Vachika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha. So, the author wants to give the definition of Jahad Ajahal Lakshana, Nirdishati Vachika. So the commentator states that the second line of the verse, it serves as a definition of Bhagatyaga Lakshana. That he wants to emphasize. Vivakshuhu tal lakshana abhidana purvakam nirdishati. Abhidana means naming. Abhidiyate iti abhidana means he gives a name. Vachika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha. Abhidana Purvaka means by indicating or the name, by indicating that name. Lakshana Abhidana Purvakam Tal Lakshana Abhidana Purvakam Nirdishati Vachyike. Vivakshu means the author, Achyuta Krishnananda Tirtha, he wants to refer to this type of Lakshana by also mentioning the name of it. He gives the definition of it. Vachyika Bhagatyagena Bhagantara Parigraha. So he says, he gives the meaning of it. Vachyartasya Ekam Bhagam Parityajya. In the commentary, Swamiji, Vachyartasya Ekam Bhagam Parityajya Anya Bhaga Svikaranam Bhagatyagakya Tritiya Lakshana Ityartha. So Eka Bhagam Svikritya. What is the Eka Bhagam? Consciousness element is retained and Devadatta element is retained. The other Bhaga, namely Dan, Sarvagnyatva and Kinchignyatva, these two are abandoned, and in this case, the different time and different place, particular time and particular place, all these are given up. So Parityajya Anya Bhaga Svikaranam Bhagatyagakya, which is known as Bhagatyaga Lakshana, Tyagakya Tritiya Lakshana Ityartha. Tadeva Aha Parikshakaha Prahuhu Ittam Bhagatyagakya Lakshanam Parikshakaha Iti Kramena Lakshana Bedan Nirdishati. Wise men, they have come to the conclusion of dividing lakshana into three types, kramena lakshana vedan nidarshayati ganga. Now previously we have just given we have just named lakshana trida prokta. Now we have already given the examples, but in the shloka he gives gangayam goshaha ityatra ya jahal lakshana tu sa. So in the case of gangayam goshaha, it is jahal lakshana. Kramena lakshana vedan nidarshayati gangayam iti tatra gangapada shakyartasya pravahasya parityagat tira roopa artasya parigrahacha. See what do we do? Gangapada shakyartasya pravahasya parityagat. You totally give up the current of the river, which is the primary meaning, and tira roopa artasya parigrahat. You consider the artha, that is tira roopa artha parigrahacha jahal lakshana ityartha. And then ajahal lakshanam nidarshayati, what is the definite, what is the example he gives? Shweto davati. The white runs. It is said the white runs. The act of running is incompatible with the white color. White color cannot run. So white color, the horse which possesses the white color, that is being conveyed. So shweto davati yantyete chatrinaha yanti. That is another example. Now in Kerala we have to give this example. Chatrinaha yanti. Because umbrellas are going. Okay. Umbrellas are going means shweto davati yanti yete chatrinaha achatrinaha tata ajahal lakshana tatra vachyartasyapi sangrahat. Because in the case of ajahal lakshana, what happens? Even vachyartha also is included, and apart from the vachyartha, something more than the vachyartha is conveyed. So that is ajahal lakshana. Now in the commentary you see shvetaha iti. Shvetaha ashvaha davati ityatra. If you clearly say white horse runs, then there is no doubt at all. But supposing you say shvetaha davati. Shvetaha ashvaha davati ityatra. Shvetapadam shuklakya varna vachyapi shuklavarna vishishtam bodhayati. Now in shvetaha ashvaha davati, shvetapadam, the word shveta, it not only conveys the sense of white color, but it also conveys the sense of the one which possesses white color. So shveta shuklakya varna vachyapi, the word shveta, also although it stands for white color, yet it does not stand with that. It conveys something more than that. Apart from giving rise to the cognition of white color, it also conveys the sense of the animal which is possessed of that white color. Shuklavarna vishishtam bodhayati, it conveys the horse which is associated with the white color. So when you utter the statement shweto davati, white runs, or shono davati, red runs, then what do you understand from this statement? The red color, the shona, that not only conveys the sense of red, also the horse which possesses the red color. In the same way, shweto davati means the horse which possesses the white color. So here these are the instances where the primary meaning is also retained, and apart from the primary meaning, something other than the primary meaning is conveyed secondarily. So vishishtam bodhayati atapi mukhyartham shuklavarnam na sarvatmana parityajati. That is what he says. It does not totally give up the primary meaning. Mukhyartha. Mukhyartha means the primary meaning. What is the primary meaning? Shuklavarnam na sarvatmana parityajati. So it is a deep contrast with that, sharp contrast with that of the jahal lakshana. In the case of jahal lakshana, mukhyartha has been totally abandoned. Not even a part of it has been retained. Sarvatmana parityagaha tatra. But in this present case, na sarvatmana parityajati iti sa ajahal lakshana ityuchyate. In the same way, evam chatrinaha yanti. In a group of students are going after the classes get over. Now we are also taking the umbrella. Chatrinaha yanti we can say because of the rainy season. So we see around 50 students are going. Only some 25 to 30 students are having the umbrella in their hands. But yet as a group, we make a statement, umbrellas are going. chatrinaha yanti. Now, there are persons who are not with the umbrellas also. But in a group, we don't make a distinction. Oh, he is one with the umbrella, he is not with an umbrella. I will count these are the persons with umbrella. All this, we don't make any distinction. But when we refer to a group of students going with the umbrella, even if one or two are without umbrella, even then we make a statement, chatrinaha yanti. So, chatrinaha yanti, when you make such a statement, you don't mean to leave out those students who are not with the umbrellas. You want to mean the entire group. But then you make a statement, chatrinaha yanti. So then, what do we understand from this sentence? Chatri, achatri, achatrinaha yanti ityatra, chatriadipadam, chatrinaha achatrinascha. Means those who are having bearing the umbrella and the persons who are not having the umbrella are also included under the fold. And this is what you mean by saying chatrinaha yanti. You don't mean to leave out those who are not with the umbrellas. So, chatrinaha yanti, here is a case where you convey the sense of not only the mukhyartha, but also something other than the mukhyartha, namely those persons who are not or who are without an umbrella, they are also being conveyed by this word chatrinaha. Chatrinaha achatrinascha bodayati iti ajahal lakshana esha. This is a kind of ajahal lakshana. Ajahal lakshana iti padam artataha vivrunoti. So ajahal, what is meant by ajahal lakshana? He says ajahal lakshana tatra vachyartasyapi sangrahat. It includes under its fold what? Vachyartha or the mukhyartha also. So vachyartasyapi iti vachyartasya ahanat. Ahanat means without leaving the vachyartha. Ahanat ajahal lakshana, because it does not leave out its primary meaning, it is called ajahal lakshana ityuchyate ityartha. Vachyartasya ahanat ajahal lakshana ityuchyate ityartha. Is it all right? Is it clear for all of you? Okay. Atha advaita vedanti bihi adritam jahad ajahal lakshanakyam bhagatyaga lakshanam aha. Advaita vedantins who admit adritam jahad ajahal lakshana. This is the sampradaya advaitins. They resort or they admit jahad ajahal lakshana. But when I refer to Vedanta Paribhasha, at least he is also a Vivaranakara. But even then he makes a deviation and he gives an entirely different view only in the case of jahad ajahal lakshana. But sampradaya, this is the sampradaya advaitins admit jahad ajahal lakshana. Jahad ajahal lakshana, which is also called bhagatyaga lakshanam aha. And what is the definition of jahad ajahal lakshana? He says viruddhamsha parityagat. Viruddhamsha means the opposing features, the contradicting features. Viruddhamsha parityagat aviruddhamsha sangrahat. So there are two meanings conveyed by two words. Now in those two meanings there is one part which is viruddhamsha, which is totally opposed to, mutually opposed to each other. So such viruddhamsha, that is being paritya, abandoned, viruddhamsha parityagat, that is being abandoned, then what is retained? Aviruddhamsha sangrahat, retaining what is not opposed to both the words. In the case of this example, it is Devadatta, and in the case of Tattvamasi, it is the consciousness element. That is being retained, viruddhamsha, aviruddhamsha sangrahat, soham ityadi vakyeshu, I am that, soham ityadi vakyeshu, sa bhagatyaga lakshana. So I am that, tattvamasi mahavakya is example, aham brahmasmi, soham ityadi vakyeshu, sa bhagatyaga lakshana, viruddha iti. He explains, I am bhavaha. The commentator tries to explain, give an example. Soyam devadattaha ityatra saha ityanena parokshadesha vartittvam. The word saha, that devadatta, it conveys devadatta who is related to a different place. Parokshadesha vartittvam means that the desha which is not in direct contact with you, means in a different place, say in that temple whom I have seen yesterday. Then I am ityanena means that devadatta is directly in front of me. ayam ityanena aparoksha deshavartitvam, devadatta who is standing in front of me, that is being conveyed by the term ayam. Ayam ityanena aparoksha deshavartitvam cha vivakshitam. This is what is conveyed primarily. Tatacha, now what are the two opposing features here? Tatacha paroksha desha vartinaha aparoksha desha vartinascha aikyam tatra pratitam. So what is intended to be conveyed is the identity between the person who is far off from me, about whom I have the immediate knowledge, whom I have seen yesterday. So I want to have the identity of the person in front of me with that person whom I saw yesterday. That is what is intended to be conveyed, tatra pratitam. Tacha na sambhavati, but such a cognition cannot arise in view of the fact, why? Paroksha, aparoksha deshayoho bedena. Since these two words convey two different adjectival elements, one is parokshatva and another is aparokshatva. These two are the adjectives given to the person Devadatta whom I am seeing in front of me. So paroksha aparoksha deshayoho bedena tad vartinorapi, even though Devadatta is directly standing in front of me, yet I cannot explain the word soyam Devadatta. When I say this is that Devadatta, it cannot be satisfactorily explained unless we take recourse to lakshana. Tad vartinorapi purushayoho beda avashyam bhavat. If you don't resort to lakshana, then you have to maintain a distinction between these two persons. The person Devadatta who is in front of me is different from the person whom I saw yesterday, because he is related to that place and that time, whereas he is standing in front of me. But in spite of all these, we do believe in the identity of the person, that is, who is standing in front of me is the same Devadatta. You have such a cognition. Now, how would you satisfactorily explain this recognition of yours unless you explain it through lakshana, jahada jaga lakshana? You cannot understand, you cannot satisfactorily explain the person or the identity of the person in Devadatta. So patatra paroksha aparoksha desha vartitva roopa visheshanamsham parityajya, leaving out the visheshana bhaga or the adjectival element, Devadatta roopa visheshyamshasyaiva. So what is the substantive element? The first one, in the first one is the different time and a different place, that is the visheshana. And this is that Devadatta, this is the visheshana. And in both instances, Devadatta is the visheshya. Now these two adjectival elements are abandoned or left off, and then visheshyamsha visheshanamsham parityajya Devadatta roopa visheshyamsha siva parigrahena tayoho abedaha upapadaniha. So the identity in the person Devadatta, that has to be maintained only by leaving out the part of the primary meaning, that is the visheshanamsha tayoho abedaha upapadaniyaha iti bhavatyesha bhagatyaga lakshana iti. And then vyanjanam gaunim cha alankarikaha pritagvrittim achakshate tan nirachaste vyanjana lakshana ityahu. This we will see later tomorrow.